Hi, everyone, once again. Trying to get in tune here. We're all trying to get in tune, aren't we? It's easy to get out of tune these days. Very easy to get out of tune. I just got out of tune by going through some internet forums. And that's, wow. It's very depressing. Because people are, you know, screaming, you know, everything's wrong, wow, wow, wow. They have no solutions. They have no idea what to do about it. That's in tune. We know that a time will come when it becomes all too much. And actually, we've reached that time. And people are realizing, whoa, this is really like a nightmare. And we can't seem to stop the nightmare. And at that point, where people seem to be incapable of sustained, careful analysis, because they say, "Hey, wait a minute, we're trapped. We're fish in a net. We're trapped," and they just start freaking out. And we're at that point right now. So it is, I realize it's difficult for people now to, you know, listen to the videos probably. And for that reason, it's difficult for me to make the videos, because I know people are just saying, wow, it's too much, it's all too much, what's happening. But that's expected. So, here, there's no surprise at all that it's all too much. Absolutely it is. I've tried to give out the various techniques that you can use to center yourself. What you need to do is you need to remain centered. Oops, I forgot. Oops, only one problem. That may be the best one. Only one problem. If someone were to ask me, Where did you go wrong? I'd say it's simple. I started seeing problems, plural, instead of one problem. That's where everybody goes wrong. That's where everybody goes off the track, is they start seeing problems, plural. Okay, so the best way to get through these times, and these are the worst times really right now. It is worse than you realize. I don't necessarily want to get into how bad it is. So let's first give the remedy. What happens is you get strung out by all the problems, plural. And you can go to forums and you can read all the stuff. You say, oh my God, there's so many problems, it's terrible. But the way that you get through this is to recognize there's only one problem. There aren't multiple problems, there's only one problem. Now, it's a gigantic problem, and so when we try to tackle it ourselves, what we do is we tend to break it into, fragment it into many, 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 many problems. It's little fragments, but it's not really fragmented at all. It's just one problem, and it's the continuity problem. That is our only problem. So the best spiritual technique right now is to say, oops, only one problem. I'm starting to get uncentered and fragmented. Oops, only one problem, only one problem. And that can quickly bring you back if you just repeat it, only one problem. It's just one problem, just only one problem. And you say, oh, there's probably just one solution too, only one problem. I can focus in on what the solution is to one problem. Whereas if I'm trying to solve thousands of problems, how can you focus in on the solutions to thousands of different problems? It drives you crazy. People are getting all bent out of shape. Best remedy that I have right now. extremities. Wow. Sounds like the apocalypse out there. It is the apocalypse. But what you want to do is you want to escape the apocalypse. How do you do that? By recognizing there's only one problem. That centers your entire psyche and being. And you say, wow, maybe it's not so difficult. If there's only one problem, I might be able to understand the solution to that problem. And when you focus on only one problem, then when the answer comes to you, you see how it applies to that one problem. You say, this problem is solved. It can be solved. The Holy Spirit solves it. So we are not without help in this time. It's just that the help comes in a way that we don't expect. That's the problem, right? We don't expect it. We don't expect it's as simple as to recognize we only have one problem, not many. But that's it. That is really the answer to centering and then being able to accept the Holy Spirit's remedy for the continuity problem. And today the Holy Spirit worked with me in an incredible way. Just the most amazing insights came today. And they're so counterintuitive that I just love them. Just the Holy Spirit, when truth comes to you, it seems very counterintuitive at first. Because you say, wait a minute. What do you mean there's nothing good in the universe? Surely that's what I'm supposed to be finding, the good. And the Holy Spirit says, no, there's nothing good in the universe at all. That's why you can't find it. And I found myself being liberated by that tremendous liberation. I said, oh my gosh, there isn't anything wrong with me. I thought there was something wrong with me. I couldn't find what's good. I couldn't find what I'm seeking for, you know, in the world, something good in the world. I couldn't find it. And now I realize I couldn't find it because there isn't any. And so there isn't something wrong with me. And it's like, I was able to breathe like from a place that I haven't been able to breathe before. It's like, oh, I finally got some breath in my spirit, as it were. And I said, and later on I said, you know, just nothing good ever happens for me. Nothing good ever happens. And then I realized that's because nothing good can happen. There isn't any good in the universe. The universe, and what furthermore the Holy Spirit told me is that the universe is a false promise that it can find, that it holds death for you. A false promise of death for you. That's literally what the universe is, a false promise of death for you. The universe tells you that it has death for you. That's its promise. And if you just seek for it, the universe tells you, if you just seek for it correctly, you will find it. But now I found out it doesn't hold any death for us at all. It's a false promise, an empty false promise. The universe is literally an empty false promise. And in hearing that, I just said, wow, that is fantastic stuff to hear that. I felt super liberated. So you might think, oh, I get so depressed. Oh, just the opposite, just the opposite. I said, holy cow. No wonder why I couldn't find what I want in the universe. You know, the universe is lying to us. It says it has death for us. It doesn't. Spirit can't die. But the universe tells us, oh no, it has death for us. We just have to go seek it. No, we don't have to seek it because it's not there. It's not anywhere. So obviously we can't find it. That's why, like Punjaji said, call off the search. Call off the search. We're seeking for our spiritual death, and the universe promises us that it has it for us, and that's a false, lying promise. So you might say the universe is a lie. It is a lie. And the universe doesn't have anything good for us, which is very true. Which is why we can't find it. But when you realize that and you stop, realize you don't have to keep seeking, you then become more aware of yourself. You start breathing and relax and say, wow, I don't need to turn my body. My body doesn't need to be a search engine. You know, really, our bodies are search engines. We're our own search engines, our own Googles. We are searching for death. We're trying to find spiritual death. And of course, why would we be doing that? Because we believe that in so doing, that we can become prime creator. Okay. We will say, God, you created us with eternal life, but we found a way to destroy that eternal life. And we have a power you don't have, and we're greater than you. So, out of our desire to die, the universe arises and tells us, yeah, I have the ways and the means to teach you how to die. You will find it here if you just work at it long enough. And we, of course, we want to believe the lie, so we do. We believe the lie. We say, oh yeah, I can succeed in finding what I want in the universe. But, of course, we cannot call off the search, give up the search. So, it's possible the spiritual path holds these riches like this, that are unexpected riches. And it's just, wow, it takes your breath away when you hear this, just like, there's nothing good at all in the universe. Nothing. And nothing good could ever come of it. Nothing good's ever going to happen to me. That's true, but that's very liberating. So then you stop looking for something good to have happen to you, and then you accept the Holy Spirit's resolution of the continuity issue, which is you're experiencing no loss of identity. Even though you're identifying with something that isn't you, but what you're identifying with doesn't lose its identity at all. It's stable. And that reminds you of your true identity. And so that solves the continuity problem for us, see? But as long as we are desperately searching for something good to happen to us, some success in the universe, we will be blind to the Holy Spirit's solving the continuity problem for us. So the Holy Spirit is getting me ready for bliss by pointing out the truth about the universe, and I accepted it very, very, very well. In fact, wonderfully. I was overjoyed. This is great. I said, keep it coming. This is the best music I've ever heard. It's wonderful. Nothing good at all in the universe. So, no need to seek anymore, right? You don't need to seek for anything good here. And since you're not seeking, what do? You accept the Holy Spirit's new perception, where you have a sense of identity, which is not losing any identity at all. Now, what is the helpfulness of these videos is that at some point, everyone will realize, uh-oh, this is worse than we thought, and we're in over our heads. And at that point, they might be able to remember these videos and say, hey, wait a minute, I remember those videos that said we only have one problem. That's it. I wasn't quite sure what they meant at the time, but now I realize, wow, that's a very, very, very helpful concept to look at. And let's get a hold of that. So hopefully these videos will have help down the line. I think right now most people are still struggling to solve problems, plural. We don't have any problems, okay? There's another way to say it. We don't have any problems at all. We don't have any problems, plural. We have just one problem, singular. Okay, when people say, well, what are your problems? Say, I don't have any problems. Okay, it's a very tricky thing in this world. They say, what are your problems? Can you tell me what your problems are? And as soon as you start to tell them what your problems are, you're lost. You've lost your center. But if you say, I don't have any problems, I have just one gigantic problem, and then people freak out. Oh, what are you talking about? You know, no. You don't need one problem. You need problems, plural. You need a fragment, they say. So, not true. That's the mistake that one makes. It's the mistake I made, the mistake everybody makes here. They say, oh yeah, okay, I've got some problems. I need to develop some problems. I realized, wow, the people here won't accept me. So I said, there's just one problem in the world, and they won't accept that. So I said, wow, I better find some problems. I better have problems. So I felt I had many, many problems. In fact, millions of problems. And then hoping that the people could relate to that. But it simply isn't true. Nobody has problems. Everybody has one problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. The continuity problem is the only problem that everybody has. And it's, and again, gigantic, seemingly unsolvable, except from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit solves it with no problem whatsoever, being especially created to do exactly that. But I find it's very difficult to get to this point. So I understand people are trying to solve problems, thinking, oh my God, I've got all these problems. But you'll be amazed what happens when you take a stand and you say, no, I only have one problem. And you say, when you name a problem, say, I think I have this problem, but I really only have one problem. You can say that, like anxiety. I think I have the problem of anxiety, but I really only have one problem, the continuity problem. No matter what problem arises, say, I think I have this problem, but I don't have this problem. I only have one problem, that's the continuity problem. Bring everything into that just one problem, and you will find that your mind becomes like miraculously focused and calms down. It's not looking all over the place. You say, whoa, wait a minute. I only have one problem, and it's a continuity problem. If you start to think that way, you have the answer, you have the key. You have the key to getting past this time right now. You have the key in your hand. You say, I only have one problem. There's only one problem. Everybody only has one problem. So those people, they say, all these problems in the news, the people think they have this problem. They don't have that problem. They only have a continuity problem. Everyone. That's all it is. So that brings you back to stability and centeredness. And then you're able to accept these really advanced turnarounds, like there's nothing good at all. There's nothing good in the world at all. Yeah, it's true, there's absolutely nothing good in the world. and we keep seeking it. We keep seeking something good. And then when we get it, we seek something better. Say, no, it wasn't quite good enough. I'll seek something better. There's nothing good at all in the world. It's all impermanence. There's nothing good about impermanence. And you don't need anything good in the world. You just need bliss, which comes not from the world, but from the Holy Spirit. Bliss doesn't come from the world, it comes from the Holy Spirit. So you don't need anything good from the world. You don't need to find the good here. There is no good to find. So you don't need to waste your time seeking for the good. So it's a miraculous escape from this fragmentation. Another plane. Wow, it's like the apocalypse out there tonight, isn't it? It is. The apocalypse is on us. There's no question about it. If it's not one thing, it gets you, it's another. Okay, so this is what we need to realize. If it's not one thing that gets you, it's going to be another. And hopefully, sooner rather than later, you catch this and you say, wait a minute. What is that? Oops, whoops, I'm in trouble. Wait a minute, oops, what's that? Only one problem. Only one problem. And it's the difference between making it and not making it. It's the difference between being on the boat or being on the shore. Because again, at some point, you'll realize, whoa, wait a minute. There's too much is going on. I can't turn the tide. There's no way I can turn the tide. It's all against me. You know, it's just, and I'm something has got me. So something is going to get you. But you can be free of it simply by saying no. This is not part of any problems I have. This is not part of problems that I have. I don't have any problems. I only have one problem. I only have only one problem. Any other problems I have, the continuity problem, and it's a whopper. It's a whopper, yes. But there's great relief in at least stopping your desperate jumping around. Like, you know, there's relief in that. Say, okay, I've got this huge problem, but I only have one problem. So if this one gets solved, that's it. That's it. I'm free. I'm free of problem. I'm truly free. So then you can sit down and stop rushing around frantically trying to solve the world's problems when you know, in fact, the world doesn't have problems. It doesn't. That's like a dreamer dreaming a nightmare, and the dreamer is reacting to all these elements of the nightmare, trying to put out all the fires. And someone tells a dreamer, hey dreamer, you don't have all those problems. You only have one problem. You only have one problem. You're dreaming. And you're afraid to wake up. You have a continuity problem because you're afraid to wake up. But all these other things, forget it. Those are just dreams. Forget about putting out all those fires. Just sit down. Relax and sit down and say, okay, I have a continuity. I'm dreaming. But I have a continuity problem, so I'm afraid to wake up. And then you say, oh boy, okay, it's not so complex. It may be big, but it's not complex. Okay, so at least you eliminate the complexity of it. And then you can focus your mind. Okay, there's a mountain there. How does that mountain get moved? And lo and behold, the Holy Spirit says, I can move it for you. I can solve the continuity problem. In fact, I have solved it. I know exactly that I know how to solve it perfectly. No problem at all. And then you start to pay attention to that. But truly, the Holy Spirit doesn't know how to solve problems. It only knows how to solve the continuity problem, because that's the only problem there is. So when you say, Holy Spirit, solve this problem for me, solve this problem, how come you're not solving my problems? I always say that. How come you're not solving my problems? And if you listen, the Holy Spirit will respond and say, you don't have any problems. You have one problem, and I've already solved that. And it's like, huh? What? So really, to listen to the Holy Spirit is amazing. It seems insolent, the Holy Spirit, you know. It seems distant, insolent, and like, what do you mean I don't have problems? You know, who are you to say that? But if you have the patience to listen to it, meaning pay attention to the ideas that percolate up into your awareness. We're like a soft drink, and the Holy Spirit is like someone comes, shakes the bottle, shakes a soft drink can or bottle, and the bubbles come rising up, you know. So we're not aware of the Holy Spirit doing it, but we're aware of the bubbles. And we say, wow, where are these bubbles coming up? There's some really nice bubbles, and they come up and fizz up, and you say, wow, I just had this incredible insight. Amazing. Where'd that come from? The Holy Spirit, you know, liberated the insight from the carbonation in you, shook it up so the bubbles are released from its saturated state in the liquid. It got released as, and now it's gas, and it's freed. It's freed. It's liberated. But you can't really listen to the Holy Spirit when you're just screaming at it, telling it to solve all your problems. Because it just has to be quiet and patiently wait until you listen to what it has to say. And it will tell us, hey, look, you know, you really don't have problems. You really don't. You have a problem, one problem, and that's it. So let's talk about this one problem that you have. Talk about anything else is a waste of time, to tell you the truth. It really is. And so it's difficult in today's day and age to not talk about problems. because it's so many in the social media, and everybody is so focused on problems. I tell you, that is going on. And so we have a situation where it's difficult to not be topical and not talk about the stuff that's going on. Otherwise, no one will listen. But the truth is that it's better to just keep emphasizing that we only have one problem and forget about all the others. Just forget about it. Just forget about it. And be the guru. You know, that's the guru. The guru is the one who says, forget about all your problems. You don't have any. You don't really have any problems. We just have this one problem, and that's all we're going to talk about. That's the guru, actually. So sometimes I would sort of fret about guru not talking about the world's problems or whatever. So how come you're not addressing that? And now I see, you know, it's counterproductive, actually. Counterproductive. So, you know, I know the gurus take my fretting in stride, knowing that I'm struggling with it, you know, struggling with this. Because you think, nobody will listen. If you're not topical, who's going to listen, actually? Because, you know, you see these videos, but just junk videos thrown out there about something real topical, and it's got, you know, 500,000 views real quickly. And you just say, wow, you know, just, maybe I can reach more people if I'm just more topical. And, but what happens is they'll be lost and I'll be lost too. So it's a lose-lose situation, which is never good. So, I guess, again, counterintuitive, if you just go entirely no topic, what do you call it, atopical, non-topical, and just say, well, let's just focus on bliss and the one, just the resolution of the one problem we have, and just make it just that, maybe many people will come and listen. That's possible. I don't know. It's counterintuitive, isn't it? Maybe I should try it. You don't have the problem Nibiru, Planet X, Comet Ison. You don't have the political, sociological problems. We don't have the world problems. We don't have any problems. We don't have any problems at all. Just the continuity problem. One continuity problem. But what people do is they keep desperately searching for problems, plural, to avoid the one big problem, because they don't know how to solve it. And they're terrified of it. They say, well, maybe if we solve like 1,000 problems, that'll be good enough. Nah, it just avoids the one problem. Just an avoidance tactic. So I'm struggling with all this, and but it's trending towards just being the guru, so to speak, which is on simply brush all their concerns aside and just realize there's one problem. You don't have many, you have one. You don't have many problems, you really don't. And just keep working on that. Because ultimately that's where everyone has to get to. They have to get to that realization. Now, that may not be easy. And I know people get very upset about it. I know I would, I did, I have. You know, it's like, what are you talking about? I've got tons of problems. No, it's only because I'm avoiding seeing that I only have one problem, and I don't have any other, more than just one problem, that I seem to have lots of problems. Because in the avoidance of realization, we fragment, thinking like, wow, no, I don't have, what better way to not see that I have only one problem than to have many, many, many problems? But I see all the videos and watch them, and you know, they get so many views and comments and everything, but there's no solution whatsoever. Absolutely nothing. Nothing. We need to stand up, you know, or something like that. Barabbas saying, hey, we need to go after Rome, you know. So there's no answer whatsoever. So what's the even use of doing that? It's a waste of time, really. They're not even on the trail of any answer. But we have the answer here, absolutely have the answer here. It's just a question of accepting it, going into bliss. Now, there's an issue with bliss. And I've seen what it is. You wonder in the world, why are people acting the way they are right now? Well, I can explain it very clearly, but it's somewhat of a complex explanation. But basically, they want deference. They want deference. They want you to defer to them. They want you to defer to their authority. And bliss treats everything as blissful. Everything. And so it doesn't seem to be any deference with bliss. Deference means you defer to someone whose authority is more informed than yours, as it were. There's a better authority. You need to defer to them. So we have a world full of people that want to be deferred to, especially the politicians and bureaucrats, etc. The Politburo of the world, they want to be deferred to because they feel they know better than you do. And so they want evidence of this deference. And so that's essentially what's driving the world right now, is there's a very strong demand for deference. They crave it, they need it, they want this deference that'll prove to them that they really are superior and have the answer for you, even though they don't. So bliss is a completely different category, completely different fish, you know. It's just, it doesn't see any loss of identity anywhere. It's just looking like, wow, there's no loss of identity here, or here, or here, or here. Everything's just like, wow, it's incredible. And so they seem to be not deferring to anybody. You know how it is when you defer to someone, it's like, oh yeah, okay, mm-hmm, yeah. And you're not in bliss, whereas bliss is just, you know, they see some big wig and they say, wow, I'm not experiencing any loss of identity here. And they see someone who's just a little scrub, and they say, wow, I'm not experiencing any loss of identity here. And they, you know, they see a speck of dust, wow, I'm not experiencing any loss of identity here. And they see the grand queen bee herself, and they say, wow, I'm not experiencing any loss of identity here. Mm-hmm. And of course the queen bee will say, why, you're seeing me equal to a speck of dust? You know, how dare you? Where's your deference to me? You know, you can't possibly, you know, I don't want to be seen as the same as a speck of dust, you know. So there's that situation there. And so these are kind of things that need to be looked at. If you really are going to go into bliss, then just looking at this kind of stuff is helpful. So basically, knowing that we have one problem, recognizing what the answer is, which is this new perception of no loss of identity. Whatever we are perceiving, we don't see it as any loss of identity whatsoever for us. And then recognizing that the world is very uncomfortable with this, because the world runs on deference, really. To tell you the truth here, which is what we do, those that we defer to, the ego anoints those that we defer to, and the ego says, look, these are the ones you should defer to. And it does it because the ego tells you that these authorities, the ones you're deferring to, know where to find death in this universe. They know where death is, and they're experts at it, and they're going to find it for you. So that's why you should defer to them. Let them lead. They will lead you to death. But we know the promise of finding death in this universe is a false, empty promise. There is no spiritual death to be found here whatsoever. The universe cannot make spiritual death. It cannot. It's just the imagination of the mind. The mind can't kill reality, can't bring death to reality, to itself, to anything. So it's an empty promise that the universe makes us, and yet there are those, the ego anoints those and says, those are the ones. They know death. They know it better than you do. So you need to defer to them. And so actually we defer simply because we believe that we're deferring to someone who knows how to find what we are seeking for, which is really spiritual death. So is it any wonder that when this whole situation gets emboldened in the world, which it has, you find that those you're deferring to are, you say, wait a minute, these people seem very self-destructive, you know? I feel a little uncomfortable deferring to them. And he said, I'm not really that self-destructive. Maybe I think the Holy Spirit might have an answer for me that's not self-destructive. And then you say, I don't want to defer to these people because they seem highly self-destructive, actually. Very grandiose, thinking like, say, I know where death can be found, and I will lead you there. So that's what's really going on. And of course it's sugar-coated and all that stuff, but again, the universe promises us, makes us a vain, false, lying, empty promise that it can produce death for us, spiritual death for us. It is going to do it for us. And we just have to hang in there, chase it down, find it, apply it, you know, all this stuff, but and follow those who know the way. And that's what's really going on. And of course, Bliss is not experiencing death at all. It says there's no death here. There's no loss of identity here. All this stuff is appearing and disappearing, but it doesn't affect my identity in the slightest bit, or at least the sense of identity, my perception of identity, which is not really identity, it's still an illusion, but it solves the continuity problem for us, which is the only issue that matters in perception. Hopefully at some point that this focus will you know, click for you. I really can't wait too much longer before I, you know, decide for Bliss, because it's either that or, you know, really jump the shark in the world. You're either gonna go one way or the other, really. You're either gonna decide, okay, I'm going with one problem. Or you're going to decide, okay, I'm going with this insane mess. I can find what I'm endlessly searching for. No, you can't. You can never find what you're searching for. Give up the search. You'll never find what you're searching for. Another way of saying, nothing good can ever happen to you. To the perception that you have now, nothing good can ever happen to this perception. Nothing good will ever happen. But you can have a new perception where nothing bad can ever happen. It's either that, you're either choosing a situation where nothing good will ever happen to you, or you're choosing a situation where nothing bad can ever happen to you. It's one or the other, actually. It's just that we try to fuzz it up so we don't recognize it. Out of tune. We fuzz it up.
There's the rascal. It's out of tune. Way out of tune.
It's okay.
It's out of tune.
Anyway, so just keeping it mellow here. Don't be too much in a hurry or frantic. I do this on purpose. so you don't get frantic. That's pretty good. Many problems, if you think you have many problems, of course you're going to get frantic. You say, why am I wasting my time with these videos? I got all these problems, I gotta solve all these problems. But if you only have one problem, you can say, okay, let's relax a little bit here. Let's take a deep breath. We have one problem and we can look at it right here, right now. So you don't need to be frantic and say, I need to go somewhere else. Relax, 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 relax. Just one problem is all you have, or anybody has. It's a fact, no matter what situation people seem to be in, it's all an avoidance, it's a dance of avoidance. It's an attempt to solve the problem, actually. Everybody's frantically attempting to solve this problem, the continuity problem. Well, there's a couple ways. The one is avoiding it, and the other is trying to find spiritual death. They think if they can find spiritual death, the continuity problem doesn't matter anymore. And by continuity problem, I mean the fear of eternal disorientation in reality. Because this dream of training program of death is so unlike reality that we just think we freak out and couldn't adjust to it. So that's a continuity problem. So they're either trying to find spiritual death right now, just got to find it, or they're saying, I've got to solve the continuity problem, but I got to do it by fragmenting it into many problems and then studying these problems, trying to solve them all, because the problem is too difficult for me. You know, I'm too scared to handle it. Neither one of those ways work. We don't solve the continuity problem. The Holy Spirit solves it. That's why we're relaxed here. We're not psychologizing. We're not saying, okay, now what do? I've got to drop the I and I've got to, you know, this and that. No. It's actually just an acceptance. We're just moving towards just a simple acceptance. Oh, okay, I can relax my efforts and let it be solved for me. I can relax my efforts and let it be solved for me. Now, you see, if we're still frantically in an effort mode of solving problems, or even this problem, any solution of it that's not coming from us, we feel is interfering with our efforts to solve the problem, and we'll get very frightened, very, very frightened. So one has to relax the efforts to solve the problem in various ways by saying, there's nothing good at all in the universe. So what am I, I'm making all this effort to, there's no good place, there's no good people, there's no good relationships, there's no good lifestyle. There's no good anything in the universe. No good anything whatsoever. And also there are no good thoughts. Thoughts are things too, actually. They're images in which you see things, in an image, like a picture or something. There's no good thoughts either. So you give up the effort of thoughts. You give up the effort of seeking people, situations, circumstances, places, things, all seeking. Of course you keep functioning, but you're not seeking to solve, you know, to find something good. What happens is your meditation goes on as you're functioning in the world. You keep reminding yourself, only one problem. There's only one problem. There's nothing good at all. I'll never find anything good because there isn't anything good to find. There's nothing good to find at all. So you relax your efforts, and once you relax your efforts, the Holy Spirit solution, you can accept it, and it doesn't seem to be interfering with your efforts, so it doesn't frighten you. So the whole key to the path is to gradually relax your efforts, gradually. Each time you'll kind of breathe a sigh of relief, like, wow, I'm so good to feel so great to put that effort down. And eventually you get to the point where you don't feel like the Holy Spirit solving the problem is interfering with your efforts, because your efforts are really in suspension, as it were. And then that's the secret to the whole thing. And then at that point, you're in bliss. But most definitely, you have to practice relaxing your efforts. Now, of course, so we don't fall into level confusion, of course, you need to practicing releasing your efforts. You need to actually do that. You need to make an effort to do this, but not the kind of forced effort, but mean you need to show up. You need to spend time at it, relaxing, without any aim, without any goal, without any program, without any idea, without any strategy at all. And just then reminding ourselves, hey, you know, of these core truths. There's only one problem. Nobody's suffering from problems. Nobody's suffering from problems. All this terrible stuff in the news, you know. They're not suffering from problems. Even death is not suffering from death. We're only suffering from the continuity problem. That's it. And the Holy Spirit is the answer to the continuity problem. So the fact that nobody has the answer to it from their own efforts, that's not a problem either. So you don't need to help others with their efforts to solve the problem, because they can't solve it. You need to show them to relax their efforts, to let go of their efforts to solve it. So we're getting really much in the ballpark here, actually. In the ballpark, and of course it's counterintuitive seemingly the whole time, isn't it? That's why for a satsang to really catch fire, you have to have one in bliss at the center of it. Bliss has to be at the center of it. So we're in this kind of vague twilight zone right now of recognizing this, but yet it's not yet started, as it were. But that's part of the situation we're in right now. Making a transition. Because only when bliss is present will people Will the situation have strong enough focus, I would say, that people can really hang in there. Right now it's too tough to hang in there. I recognize that. I recognize it. It's too tough for viewers to hang in there. Yeah, they want answers now, and yet they need to be pulled away from answers with an S to simply the answer. And bliss is the answer. And so that answer needs to be there to pull people away from answers. So right now we're in a tug of war. Do I go for the answers, or do I go for the answer? Which one? A lot of planes tonight over here. It's unusual. So bliss helps, you know, win the tug of war is what it does. Thank you. kids and teenagers and stuff wander around in the evening night. Walking up and down the road, it's summertime, and kids get out and get up to mischief, probably. The deer came by and ate all plants outside the fencing. Of course, they ate them. They're hungry. The paradox of the satsang is that people think when someone's in bliss, oh, okay, they can tell me how I can get the answer, or I can tell me, you know, how I can get the answer or something. But people sometimes get very intense, like, okay, this is it. But they're still trying to solve the continuity problem themselves. And they think that the one in bliss has done this, and they have not. They've given up trying to solve it themselves. So that's a whole different thing. So sometimes people are, you know, confused about that, like, wow, what's going on here? That's why many come in, but not all finally see it. It's not easy to see it the right way, of course not. I've struggled with that, you know, my whole life, of course. You struggle. But it's the struggle that is important, that you try and bring it into focus, and then you need to just relax and say, no, just relax. Don't struggle so hard. Don't struggle so hard. And of course, only bliss can really convey that, hey, no need for any struggle. Don't struggle so hard. Gradually, it melts the struggle away. But without that bliss, the problem, people will try too hard. They'll try too hard. Or they'll just go away. They either try too hard or they'll just go away. But bliss can convey the sense of, hey, you know what, maybe I need to just chill out a little bit. Maybe I can just let go of some of this effort. Maybe I can do that. That's the sense that bliss can give people. So it's actually helpful. It's actually quite helpful. Actually quite helpful, yeah. So, we will see what we can do as far as acceptance goes. Drop the effort. Drop the search. I know I'll never find anything good in this universe. It's impossible. And I know that nothing good will ever happen to me. That's a great one. It's true. Because the bliss isn't happening to me. It's not happening to the me. It's happening to everything. It's a new perception. But as far as this perception goes, nothing good will ever happen to this perception. We call it me. This perception we have. Nothing good will ever happen to it. Never. So, just some time spent considering this is worth more than a lifetime of effort trying to solve problems. Just a few moments considering this is worth more than an entire lifetime. That's a fact. So, we don't have to be in any hurry. You can spend a little time on this. Nothing good could ever happen for me. It's true. In my life, I can say nothing good has ever happened for me. That is true. And I can see nothing will ever good happen for me. Not really. Not really. All sorts of stuff you hope might be it, and it's never it. Of course, because what we're seeking for in the universe is our spiritual death. That'll never happen. It'll never happen. And since that'll never happen, that gives us this incredible continuity problem. Like, well, how do we drop this universe? And that's the Holy Spirit says, hey, don't worry, you don't have to drop it. First, get this feeling of identity that is not suffering any loss whatsoever. And then that'll solve the continuity problem for you, and then you can drop it all. So don't be in this frantic state, you know. We need a guru. A guru is great, really. A guru is great. The one that is truly in bliss is really a great boon.
That is for sure.
Maybe we'll get one. Because they're not frantic at all. They're entirely unfrantic. Because they know that no matter what happens, they're not going to suffer any loss of identity whatsoever, none. So what are they frantic about? Even your failure to realize this is not going to cause them any loss of identity. We may think that it'll help us if the guru is concerned that if we don't succeed with the help they give us, that they're going to feel a loss of identity, so that makes them help us more or something. Or it makes us work harder not to cause the guru problems or something. But if you look at it carefully, it's not true. It's not true. Because that undermines the entire situation. You say, wait a minute, this vision they're talking about, this new perception, it does suffer loss. So it's not trustworthy. So even the total failure of the devotees of the guru doesn't cause them to suffer any loss of identity whatsoever. They're still completely in bliss. And the guru might say, ah, you're heartless, you're heartless, you're cruel. even the criticisms of the devotees does not cause a loss in bliss, loss of identity at all from the guru. And then the devotees see that, they say, ah, this one has the answer. Nothing bothers them. They don't feel any loss of identity at all. So, and the gurus are carefree. You know, they're carefree. What are they worried about? What are they worried about? That you're going to fail? Not even worried about that. Your failure doesn't cause them any loss of identity. And you say, that's not fair. But that too doesn't cause them any loss of identity. Nothing does. Because the only issue is the solving the continuity problem, not fairness. Everything in reality is fair. Nothing in this death training program is fair. Nothing at all. So why are we talking about fairness? If you have only the choice between complete fairness and no fairness, do we need to even talk about fairness? Just solve the continuity problem. One moment, please. All right, we're back. So you see, we've just easily gotten into something very important. Feeling the guru's not fair, they're not. They're showing us there's a state that doesn't suffer. What else do you want them to show? No, that's the guru. If they're showing something else, they're not the guru. If they're showing suffering, they're not the guru. Period. As I'm not a guru because I'm showing suffering. No suffering. The guru's not, doesn't suffer. And so we have to decide, do we want a guru or not? That's a choice, you know? Some people say, well, I want a guru, but not that kind. Well, they don't want a guru, then there's only one kind of guru. And that's the guru who doesn't suffer. There's only one kind of guru, there's not two kinds. So they really don't want a guru. They want is to see, okay, what can suffer loss of identity, and how can I avoid that thing? You know, how can I shuffle the deck of cards? And then they're not looking for the answer. They're still trying to solve problems. They don't recognize the continuity problem is the only problem there is. If they did, then they'd accept the guru. Really, acceptance of the guru comes when you see you only have one problem. Truly. So make that your goal. Make it your goal to see, I only have one problem. Only one problem, a continuity problem. Then it's easy to accept the guru. You say, oh, guru, it's wonderful. I see that this is the solution to the continuity problem. It's been solved for you. The Holy Spirit solved it for you. Great. It's easy. But when you have problems, you say, hey, guru, how come you're not working? You've solved one problem. Maybe what about all the others? You're just getting off on solving one problem, but it's not fair to us because we have lots of problems and you're not helping us with that. We're coming to see you and giving you deference, but you're not working on our problems. You know, so again, they're not ready for the guru. Those who are like that are not ready for the guru. So you would expect that I'm ready for the guru. You would expect that from what I'm saying. From what I see, I feel I'm ready for the guru. We'll see if the guru shows up. They say, Ananda Maimon said, when the disciple's ready, the guru will always appear. It's a spiritual law. Well, I have to say I'm ready because I'm able to recognize we only have one problem. That's it, and accept it. And accept that there's no good at all to be found in the universe. None. Not with this perception. It's impossible. And so I believe I can handle the guru. I can accept the guru is happy all the time. And is not suffering any diminishment of bliss at all, no matter what. So I would expect, and I would expect the guru will appear. I guess it's supposed to happen inevitably. So we'll see. Well, I believe it will happen. So again, stay relaxed. Say, whoops. When you get tense and frantic, say, whoops. I'm frantic. Whoops. Whoops, 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 whoops. Oh, only one problem. Only one problem, yeah. Even when you're fixing all these problems, quote unquote problems, come, all the light bulb went out, all the battery went out, you say, this is not a problem, there's only one problem. The fact that this is arising is an avoidance, it comes from denial, actually. So I'm still functioning fine. In fact, better than ever, fixing all these problems and people, you know, just doing all this stuff. But I keep telling myself, there's only one problem. It just covers everything. It's all inclusive. It's all inclusive. is gigantic. It includes the light bulb that goes out. It includes the battery that dies. It includes the jar you can't open up. It includes everything. But it's only one problem. It's not many. Because the fact is, if we didn't have this continuity problem, none of this stuff would exist at all. None of it. Nothing that you perceive would exist at all. You wouldn't even be perceiving. There'd be no perceiver. There'd be no perception. There'd be no subject. There'd be no object. There'd be no universe. There'd be nothing that we're perceiving. Vanish, completely vanish. Because it never was. It was only a presumption of what was hoped to be. Like a mirage. It was only a mirage, really. So, it's the continuity problem that sustains all of this. Totally sustains it, entirely sustains it. Nothing else sustains it. It's the continuity, our fear sustains it. Fear of the continuity issue sustains all of this. So again, the continuity problem is the only problem we have. Just listen to the crickets. And let your franticness, you know, just kind of quietly subside. It's like something shaking up. Shaking up a soft drink. Ah, fizzy, fizzy, fizzy. Let it calm down. Let the bubbles calm down. Let it all gradually calm down. Settle down. So the guru is not something that is frantic. It's not something that is intense. It's not that. No. It's relaxed. It's a little funny. You know, you want to chuckle. It's a relaxed chuckle. And it's at ease, a sense of ease, just like, peaceful ease. I got an easy, peaceful feeling. I got it. peaceful feeling. So it's an easy, peaceful feeling. An easy, peaceful feeling. I'm imagining it right now, the guru. I'm imagining it. It's like, wow. The guru's actually very happy to see you. He should be very happy because they know you're just about ready to get it, you know, and that's great. And that you accept the fact that they see no wrong anywhere. Everything's perfect and no loss of identity anywhere. So, I can just imagine it. I can imagine it in my mind, you know, I can see it. I can see it. Like the guru is right here. I can see it and catch the feeling, the vibe. That's great. So, all right. Well, folks, we do need the guru in our lives, as it were. The bliss guru, the true bliss guru. Because that will really help us get this peaceful, easy feeling that I tell you, we have really lost. And I know people are saying, hey, you know what? I don't think I'll ever get it back. I was driving in the truck today, and I got it. I got this feeling. Like, I connected with a feeling I had long ago in this lifetime. Like, the most beautiful feeling I had, you know, in this lifetime. It's like, oh, man, the heat of the day, the clarity of the day with the air conditioner on. I was kind of drowsy. And I reminded of some time near the ocean. It was just like almost like epiphany. Of a paradise. It was just beautiful, beautiful feeling I had today just driving along. I said, just wow. I haven't felt that way in a long time. Long time. It's a peaceful, easy feeling. Came to me. I got a peaceful, easy feeling. I don't know the lyrics. That I know. Let me down, 'cause I'm all ready to stand on the ground. There, you know, used to be a lot more of a peaceful, easy feeling in the world. I'm telling you that for sure. When I connected with this feeling, I said, oh my God, where did that feeling go? Oh my gosh. It's like from the 60s, this feeling I had. It's like, whoa. We're so far away from that now. I just, well, that's just like out of the blue, you know, it came just out of the blue. It's like, holy smokes. Where has that feeling gone? Where's that been? I got a peaceful, easy feeling. And I know you won't let me down, 'cause I'm all ready standing, yeah, on the ground, of course, already standing on the ground, something like that, I don't know, if that's not it, it's good enough. So, with the guru, you get the peaceful, easy feeling, you feel it, and you say, whoa, where's that been? Where's that been, oh my God, where's that been? Where's it been hiding? Where have you been? And where'd it go? When it leaves, you're like, where'd it go? Holy smokes. Yeah, it came upon me. I was just driving, and suddenly I said, oh, what is this feeling I'm feeling? Wow, it's amazing. Because everything was perfect. Everything seemed just perfect. Admittedly, it was an incredible day in the Bay Area of California today, folks. It was... now maybe it was 86, but it was like an autumn day, except there was more of it. Like a perfect autumn day. Imagine a perfect autumn day, and yet there was more of it. The one problem with the autumn is that it gets light, dark too early. There's not enough of it. That today was like there was an abundance of it. And I caught the feeling, I said, oh my God, this is just like, wow. It's like I'm feeling the Pacific Ocean in some kind of mellow mood or something. Wow. This is California at its best. You felt the whole thing. The whole vibe was felt. That's why people come to California is sometimes you catch this vibe here and it's just like, whoa. This evening too is just incredible. Just incredible. There's a crisp freshness to the air, and yet it's warm. There's a warm, crisp freshness and mellow. You know, it's just like, that's like very nice. You know, a lot of times you just hang out with the guru. Just hang out. You don't have to ask questions. Everyone just kind of hangs out in silence. Or you might be a little talk and smiles and a little laughter and maybe a tune or two occasionally. But mostly, you just hang out. You just hang out with the top-notch guru. You just hang out. You can just hang out. Sometimes there can be some structure, but oftentimes you're not trying to impose silence on yourself. No, it's beyond that. It's bliss. And you're just kind of noticing that the guru's always in bliss. You just notice it. And you kind of chuckle and laugh and say, that's quite something. That's really something. Wow. The real guru bows to you, actually, to tell you the truth. But that's really something, too. And they're letting you know that you're not causing them the slightest loss of identity. That's what they do. They bow to you and just acknowledge, you know, hey, don't worry. You're not causing me any troubles whatsoever. And you get that feeling from them. You get that feeling. You're not causing them any troubles whatsoever. Huge burden off of you, because you finally have an experience that you're not causing someone any problems at all. Whereas, you know, everyone else, we feel we're all causing each other problems, right? No matter what we do, we're causing problems. Can't win. But here with the guru, you can't lose. You cannot lose. You can never cause them any problems. Maybe I'll learn that song. Peaceful feeling. And I know won't let me down. Cause I'm already standing on the ground. You don't even need to do the inquiry with the real guru. You don't. You don't have to do all this soul searching, this frantic effort. Okay, now, what do? I get up in the morning, you know, it's like I had it and then it lost it and all of that. just the effort, you know. And now how do you, you know, this questions of how do we do this, you know, how do we solve our problems? I'm trying to solve it. This guru doesn't have any problems. They're not even making any effort to solve any problems. They don't have any. And it's not because you're doing everything for them. Not because you're worshiping them. No, doesn't matter, any whatever. Let anything happen whatsoever, the guru is not bothered by it at all. And you see, just notice that. And you just say, wow. Very interesting. And so you'd rather be noticing that than trying to think of a question to ask. You don't want to ask any questions, you're too busy paying attention. This whole thing about satsang, trying to ask questions, I don't like it. You know, it's like you go to satsang, okay, maybe I need to get up on the hot seat and ask some questions. What question am I going to ask? You know, so I can think, like, I'll get all uptight, like thinking, you know, what's the right question to ask? You know, gosh, I don't want to, you know, not ask the right question. I got to really get into it and dig deep with the guru, you know, dig deep with the satsang and all this stuff. No. With a real guru, you feel like you don't have to ask any questions because the answer is already here. So why would you be asking questions? You just say, wow, let me just pay attention to the answer here. It's far too interesting to ask questions. You don't want to break your concentration that way, and you don't want to be thinking like, what do I need to ask? That's such pressure, terrible pressure. Forget it. No need to ask those things. You're not obligated to ask any questions. Okay, very great. That peaceful, easy feeling. You know, if you feel it, you can feel it. I felt it today. It's there. Wow. As big as the Pacific Ocean, I'm telling you. It felt like the Pacific Ocean. Just felt like it. All right. If you get off track, say, oops, I got off track. Only one problem. That's it. Very great. That's it.